We welcome you to worship at Mount Washington Baptist Church. Please take these next few moments to prepare your hearts to worship God as you listen to the prelude.
Our opening hymn is number 258. We are gathered for thy blessing from 1 Corinthians 2. My message and my preaching were with the demonstration of the Spirit's power.
To greet one another. If you have your phone handy, you can text someone and say, God loves you.
Good morning. First, let me say that Barb and I certainly have missed seeing everyone at church on Sunday mornings, and we both hope that everybody has been staying well. As a financial secretary, I wanted to thank all of you who have continued to send in your weekly offerings during this time that we've been apart due to the coronavirus. However, because we haven't been gathering on Sunday mornings, our weekly offerings have declined significantly. And I just wanted to remind everyone that even though we're not physically together, you can still mail in your offerings to the church by addressing it to Financial Secretary, Mount Washington Baptist Church, P.O. Box 30437, Cincinnati, Ohio 45230. You can also send it in electronically by going to the church website, which is mwbcares.net. Click on Donate. And then initially you'll need to create a username and password for security purposes. Then select which offering you want to donate to, whether it be a regular weekly offering or your monthly D&D fund. You'll also select whether you want to donate, make it a one-time donation, weekly, bi-weekly, monthly, or semi-monthly. And of course, include the donation amount, and be sure to have your bank account information or your credit card information available, because you'll be putting that in as well. If you have any questions, don't hesitate to call me. I'm in the church directory, or you can call the church office at 513-231-4445. And if no one answers, simply leave a message. And as soon as I get that message, I promise I will call you back and help you in any way that I can. Thank you.
We will now hear our children's story from our brother Dale Adams.
Would the children come down for the children's story?
Hey, Tom, how are you today?
Well, hello, Dale. What are you eating?
Oh, I'm eating ice cream. I love ice cream. Do turkeys like ice cream?
Dale, I'm not here to eat. I'm here to help you get your work done. We have to plant this tree, then we have to fix the hole in the roof, then we have to power wash the patio, you know, for summertime.
I know. It just seems like the work really never gets finished around here.
Well, that's true in our lives as well. Dale, God is always working on us to make us into the kind of person He wants us to be.
That's so true, Tom.
God will be working on us for the rest of our lives. When He gets finished with one part, it will be time to start working on another.
That's right. And in the Bible it says, "Then I pray that your love will overflow more and more, and that you will keep growing in knowledge and understanding of one another."
Woo! When we plant good seeds, we'll grow great into great Christians.
And aren't you glad we didn't use bananas this week?
Hey, aren't you glad that Kroger has oranges back in stock? All right, back to you, Pastor Ken, helping us to grow into great Christians.
Weren't you glad you heard the children's story from Dale Adams? The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Into your presence we come, dear Father, knowing that we can cast all our cares on you because you care for us. We need not have fear because you are our light and our salvation. We need not have fear because you are the stronghold of our lives. Thank you for your divine presence. Thank you for your gifts of grace and mercy. We ask, O Lord, for the forgiveness of our sins and that you would cleanse our lives as we repent and turn our lives in the direction that you would like us to turn. We thank you, Father, for your blessings in our life. We thank you for our health. We thank you for our homes. We thank you for our families. We thank you for the fellowship that we enjoy one with another as a part of our wonderful church. We ask, O Lord, your blessings upon us and our nation. We pray for peace in our world. We ask, O God, that you would bring healing to those who have the coronavirus. We pray for its containment. We pray for comfort and blessings to be with those who have lost loved ones. We pray for our government and all those, Lord, who are leading us and guiding us through these troubled times. Thank you, Lord, for your divine presence, and we know, Lord, that all things are in your control. We ask, O God, that you would bring help and healing to those, Lord, who are struggling at this time. We pray for healing for Dane Hoder. We pray for healing for Maxine Racer. We pray for healing for Mary Lou Newman. We pray for healing for Randy Swanson. We pray for healing for Helen Wood. We pray for healing for Brian Shaw. We pray for healing for Diane Steelman. We pray for healing for Linda Oliver. We pray for healing for Lisa Clark. We pray for healing for Rob Clark. We ask your healing grace to be with Marcia Johnstone. We pray for healing for Carlin Talmadge. We pray for healing for Kelly's parents, Norma and Dwayne. We pray for healing for John Oliver. We pray for healing for Letta Davis. We pray for healing for Charlie Saulberger. And we pray for healing for Lynn Saulberger. We ask your grace and healing to be with Melba Smith. Please bless, Lord, all of our shut-ins, all of those who are residing in retirement homes, and Lord, those who are struggling with isolation. We thank you for your many blessings, and in these moments of prayer, we want to lift up to you missionaries who are serving you around the world. Please bless all of our missionaries. We lift up Emerson and Ivy Wu to you and ask your blessings on their service in China. Thankful are we, Lord, for your presence all throughout the world. We know that you are touching lives everywhere, and we thank you for touching our lives. Hear us, O Lord, as we pray together the very words of Jesus who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The word of the Lord from Philippians chapter 1, verses 3 through 11. I thank my God every time I remember you. In all my prayers for all of you, I always pray with joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. It is right for me to feel this way about all of you, since I have you in my heart. For whether I am in chains or defending and confirming the gospel, all of you share in God's grace with me. God can testify how I long for all of you with the affection of Christ Jesus. And this is my prayer, that your love may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight, so that you may be able to discern what is best and may be pure and blameless until the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ to the glory and praise of God. Each year, Facebook founder and CEO Mark Zuckerberg gives himself a personal discipline challenge. In 2014, Zuckerberg revealed that he challenged himself to write one thank you note each day. In a Bloomberg Businessweek cover story, he vowed to write a well-considered thank you note every day via email or handwritten letter. His reasoning was, "It's important for me because I'm a really critical person. I always kind of see how I want things to be better, and I'm generally not happy with how things are or the level of service that we're providing for people or the quality of terms that we built." And so this thank you letter approach helped him to be in a warmer position with his employees. Douglas Conant, the former Campbell Soup CEO, takes this practice to the next level. Conant says that he wrote at least 30,000 thank you notes to employees over the course of his 10-year career. He committed about an hour each day to writing thank yous, which is a lot of time in a Fortune 500 CEO's schedule. He usually made time for it during his commuting or while traveling. Conant said, "Most senior executives develop the skill set that's largely based around critical thinking. They get really good at it and tend to really develop the muscle of trying to critique things more than compliment them."
Tom Peters, a management expert, adds that the notes should also be handwritten. When it comes to thank you notes, barely readable scrawl is the best. It really says you're being personal. Peters also says they're particularly effective when sent to low-level employees who will be more impressed to hear from someone at the top. This demonstrates a growth in a person. Mark Zuckerberg is still growing. So is Douglas Kanaan. The Apostle Paul begins his letter to the Philippians with a word of thanks. And it's a thank you to God. In verses 3-6, we read, I thank my God every time I remember you. In all my prayers for all of you, I always pray with joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. Paul thinks highly of the Philippians for a couple of reasons. One is that they're in a partnership. Paul is writing from a Roman prison, and he has put people in charge of the church that is in that city. Another reason is that he believes God is working in them, and God won't stop until it is completed. The word in the Greek for work is ergon, from the word ergo, which means to accomplish. These words, good and work, are used in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 10, where we read these amazing words. We are his workmanship, created in Christ for good works, which God has prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. If you sent someone a card to let the person know you're thinking of her or praying for her, God already had the card picked out. He knows in advance what you're going to do. He's prepared the good works for you to do. So it's important for us to respond to God when he prompts us. That's how we grow in love. That's how we grow in our love for God. That's how we grow in our love for each other. It was C.S. Lewis who said, joy bursts in our lives when we go about doing the good at hand and not trying to manipulate things and times to achieve our own joy. You'll have joy if you do good things for others. In verses 7 and 8 of Philippians chapter 1, Paul writes, it is right for me to feel this way about all of you, since I have you in my heart. And whether I am in chains or defending and confirming the gospel, all of you share in God's grace with me. God can testify how I long for all of you with the affection of Christ Jesus. So what is Paul saying here? He's saying that he loves the Philippians. He's saying that they are in a partnership together. He's saying that he longs for them spiritually. The word that's used here for affection in the Greek is splagnois, which is referring to inward parts or the emotions. So in other words, he's not faking it. This is coming from the heart, his desire to be with them and his desire to see them. It's about love, and he's not talking about a superficial love. He's talking about something that comes from inside of him. In verses 9 through 11, the Apostle Paul writes in Philippians 1, and this is my prayer, that your love may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight, so that you may be able to discern what is best and may be pure and blameless for the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ to the glory and praise of God. The word for abound is, in the Greek, is parousio, and it means over and above. So in other words, you're doing more than what's expected. You're doing beyond the minimum. And if you love people, you'll be thinking of them, and you'll have knowledge of them because you talk to God and ask him, what should I do for these individuals? You'll have an insight into their lives and into your own life, so you will know how to love others. You'll be talking to God about these individuals, and God will be speaking to you. That's a growing love. But at times it's difficult for us to choose. Should I write a note? Should I make a phone call? Should I take this person out to lunch? What should I do, Lord? I received a card from my mom 4 years before she passed away, and it's dated May the 4th, 1993. And this is what she said. "Dear Ken, as Mother's Day approaches, I've been thinking of how happy and proud I am to be your mother. Your children are such beautiful gifts to a grandparent. When you are my age, I hope you will say to them how happy they have made you as you have made me. Mom." Now, one of the things I wanted to say about note writing is that when you write a note or send a card to someone, you're not sure how long they're going to keep it. But I've kept that card for 27 years. And it touches my heart every time I pull it out and look at it. And I think about how blessed I am for the children that my wife and I have, and for our grandchildren. And it reminds me of my mom. And that's a choice that you have to make. How will you communicate with other people? How will you touch their lives? And God will lead you in that choice if you talk to Him and let Him speak to you. Tess Brigham is a licensed psychotherapist who specializes in treating those in the millennial generation. It wasn't her decision, they just came flocking to her practice. Brigham says, 90% of my patients are between the ages of 23 and 38. The rest are usually the parents of millennials. Over the last 5 years of her practice, she's noticed a dominant theme when it comes to the clusters of problems about which these millennials keep coming to seek help. They say to her, "I have too many choices, and I can't decide what to do. What if I make the wrong choice?" Psychologist Barry Schwartz has a theory as to why this is the case. In his book, The Paradox of Choice, Schwartz argues that people are more likely to regret their choices if they have too many options from which to choose. They either make poor choices, make good choices, but feel bad about them, or refuse to choose, which is itself a choice. Brigham counsels her clients to practice self-awareness and to identify their options, especially zeroing in on the things that they can control. It's easier to embrace the uncertainty of the outcome if they can offer themselves grace and acceptance. If I was talking to Tess Brigham, what I would say to her is, people over the age of 60 have a hard time making choices too. We all struggle with choices, don't we? One of the most fruitful choices that's ever recorded in the Bible is in the 16th chapter of Acts, verses 25 through 34. Paul, the apostle, and his partner Silas were in a prison. And the reason they were in that prison is because the apostle Paul had delivered a slave woman from a demon that was inside of her. And her owners were using her to predict the future. And so when that power was no longer available to her, they had Paul and Silas arrested and thrown into a prison where they were beaten and then handcuffed. It says in Acts chapter 16, about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the other prisoners were listening to them. Suddenly there was such a violent earthquake that the foundation of the prison were shaken. At once all the prison doors flew open and everyone's chains came loose. The jailer woke up, and when he saw the prison doors open, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself because he thought the prisoners had escaped. But Paul shouted, "Don't harm yourself, we're all here." The jailer called for lights, rushed in, and fell trembling before Paul and Silas. He then brought them out and asked them, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" They replied, "Believe in the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved, you and your household." Then they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all the others in his house. At that hour of the night, the jailer took them and washed their wounds. Then immediately he and all his household were baptized. The jailer brought them into his house and set a meal before them. He was filled with joy because he had come to believe in God, he and his whole household. As we read this story, we see some choices that were made. First is the choice to praise God. They're singing hymns to God, even though they're in prison. Secondly, there is this idea of staying close to one another. One of the interesting things about Paul and Silas is that Silas didn't get mad at Paul for getting them thrown into jail. He could have said, "Why are you always delivering people from demons? Why did you have to do that? Why did you get us stuck in this jail?" But Silas doesn't say that. He and Paul stay close to one another because they're doing the work of God. And then stay close to people who need God. Now, today, perhaps there is someone who's out there listening to this message who's never accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. This could be the perfect day for you to begin an eternal relationship with Jesus Christ. You may pray this prayer. Dear Lord Jesus, I know that I am a sinner, and I ask for your forgiveness. I believe that you died for my sins and rose from the dead. I turn from my sins and invite you to come into my heart and life. I want to trust and follow you as my Lord and Savior. In your name I pray, amen. That reminds me that one of the best notes that God ever sent to you and me was Jesus. The Bible tells us in John chapter 1, verse 14, the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. What an amazing word that came to us from God. It was Jesus Christ, in whom we have salvation. So what do we see Paul and Silas doing in this Philippian jail? It's interesting that the very people that he wrote this letter to live in the town where he was imprisoned with Silas. And I always wonder when I see this letter to the Philippians if the Philippian jailer is listening to it being read, because it completely changed his life on the day that he met Paul and Silas. One of the things that we observe about Paul and Silas is that they're led by the Spirit. And that's what we should do. We should be led by the Holy Spirit. On this Pentecost Sunday, we recognize that the Holy Spirit is a gift from God, and he dwells inside all who believe in Jesus Christ, all who have made him Lord of their lives. We read in Romans chapter 8, verses 13 and 14, "For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the misdeeds of the body, you will live. For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God." That's the identifying mark of a child of God. He or she is being led by the Holy Spirit. And you know, to grow in love is your choice. You get to make that choice. God's not going to make it for you. It's up to you. But if you're led by the Holy Spirit, God chooses how you will spend your todays and your tomorrows. Colin Powell once said, "None of us can change our yesterdays, but all of us can change our tomorrows." Someone who changed his tomorrow is Fabian Bellamy. Not long ago, as a business student at Georgetown University, he gave a friendly nod to the night shift janitor who was working in his study room. That student, Fabian Bellamy, is the founder of a group called Unsung Heroes, which is dedicated to spotlighting and raising funds for the invisible workers on the campus. That janitor, O'Neill Batchelor, is a gifted cook, and now he has a website for his chicken catering business. Once Bellamy had struck up a friendship with Batchelor, the once invisible worker, he couldn't help but wonder about all the others. The plumbers, the window cleaners, the cashiers. He began sharing photos and stories on the Unsung Heroes Facebook page. I wonder what Mark Zuckerberg would say about that. The stories got shared, and the stories got liked, and the stories got loved. And students are doing more than just posting their appreciation. For instance, the same students who once silently handed their meal cards to Umberto Ripi, who is a cafeteria cashier, just raised more than $5,000 on a GoFundMe page for him to go to South Sudan. Repai's family lives in South Sudan, and he hadn't seen them for 45 years. In Bachelor's words, it's like the door is cracked open in front of me, and I can smell the air coming through. The inspiration. You are growing in love if you do things for others tomorrow that you did not do today. So let's grow in love. Let's keep growing and let the Holy Spirit lead us in what we do for God and for others. May we pray. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for your message of love. Thank you, Lord, that you sent Jesus into the world to die for our sins, that we might receive grace and forgiveness and eternal life. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for reminding us in these words that we should do more and more and abound in love so that we may discern what is best and be pure and blameless for the day of Christ. Help us, Lord, to abound in your love and to do things that people don't expect us to do. Help us to reach out and touch others and to keep growing in love day by day as we do the things for others that you want us to do. May you be praised and glorified in our lives, we pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Our invitation song is number 364, My Jesus, I Love Thee, Psalm 116, I love the Lord, for he heard my voice.
Of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, our Heavenly Father, the fellowship and the communion of the Holy Spirit, be and abide with you this day and forevermore. Amen.